The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you can listen from the station website at radiolex.us. It is October the 19th. 2023, 4:01 to be exact. We are live and we are in color, ladies and gentlemen. Still slap dab in the middle of spooky season, which is my favorite time of the year. But folks, not to start the show off on a somber note, but I would be remiss if I didn't bring up the death of Suzanne Summers, who I grew up watching. She was a household name, and I think most people know Suzanne Summers from her time on Three's Company. But Suzanne Summers, folks, became a household name after starring on the hugely popular television show Three's Company. She died on Sunday morning at her Palm Springs home. She was 76 years old. She died the day before her 77th birthday, just one day shy of turning 77. That's something, isn't it, that you die a day before your birthday? And she had struggled with breast cancer for 20-something years. She fought against it for a long, long time. And I'm glad to fortunately hear that she did pass away in her home peacefully and surrounded by her family. It's never good to pass away anyway, and it's always sad, and I don't think there's really an easy way to pass away, but to hear that she passed away peacefully with her home is good to hear. Suzanne Summers, I wrote about her on my Twitter when I heard that she passed away. She is the perfect example of resilience when things take a dark turn in your career. She was fired from her hit television show, Three's Company, just to bounce back as an icon in the fitness world and to star in another successful sitcom. But let's start talking about her time on Three's Company, which is what she was known for. It's got the huge
"Come and knock on our door."
The huge
"We've been waiting for you"
jingle that you guys are used to hearing. Three's Company, starring John Ritter. She played Chrissy on the show, and she was the ditzy blonde secretary. And she starred along John Ritter and Joyce DeWitt from 1977 to 1981. She was dropped during the show's fifth season after a widely publicized salary dispute in which she reportedly asked for a raise from $30,000 an episode to, get this, $150,000 an episode, which would be the equal pay of her male co-star, John Ritter. And you would think she deserved it because she was just as popular as John Ritter and Joyce DeWitt. It was the show about them. It was called Three's Company. So she wanted equal pay. I don't think anything was wrong with that. I think that because of the time it was, she wasn't going to ever get that. But you have to hand it to her for trying. And it makes you think that if people would have had her back, they would have kept her. But Hollywood is a cutthroat business, and nobody wanted to have her back when she asked for that raise. You know, the cast of Friends, they all went together, and they asked for a raise for $1 million an episode. And they never asked for a raise without somebody else on the cast getting a raise. But Suzanne Summers, when she asked for a raise, nobody came to her defense, and they let Three's Company fire her. And it was very sad for her because she was one of the most watched females on television during that time, and she was one of the most popular females on television during that time. And when she asked for a raise, they cut her. They cut her from being on television. It destroyed her career. It got around that she was difficult to work with, and they really demeaned her on the set of Three's Company once they fired her, because they fired her halfway through the fifth season. And for the rest of the show, they really stuck it to her character. They limited her to only like 30 to 60 seconds an episode. Take a listen when she talks about it in an interview she did years ago.
So what they did do was force me to finish out the year, but diminish me to a minute at the end. They built a little side set. It was crazy what they did. They would have a police guard come meet me at the back door, walk me in. I was not allowed to see anybody from the original show, only the wardrobe guy who would bring me a pair of shorts and something. And my set was a chair and a phone and a lamp and one camera. And I would speak to myself on the phone and go, oh, I'm so sorry, I know she's still sick, I wish I could be there. And I did that to finish out the season. And I would usually leave in tears because it was just so, it just felt so like I was being punished, like I was a bad girl, brought up all my old feelings.
Well, that and it is very sad that they did that to her. They demeaned her character. And they went on to say that she was fired because she was late to production shootings and things like that. But no, at the end of the day, she was fired simply because she asked for a raise. And it's very sad that that happened. But, like I said, Susan Summers is resilient. She didn't let the firing of Three's Company to define her. She bounced back, and she headlined her own Las Vegas show in the 1980s at the Las Vegas Hilton, and she performed a two-hour show seven nights a week, and she ended up winning Female Entertainer of the Year, right along Frank Sinatra as Male Entertainer of the Year. Now, after her Vegas show, she got back into television sitcom acting and starred in the very successful show Step by Step.
Step by step.
This show ran from 1991 to 1997. She starred alongside Patrick Duffy. And this is really how I know Susan Summers. She was the mom from Step by Step, starring, her name was Carol on the show, and she brought in, she married an old construction worker, and she had her own kids. He had his own kids, and they became a blended family. It was kind of like a modern-day Brady Bunch show, but it was awesome. And she was a very, very attractive 40, 50-year-old lady. You gotta love Step by Step. And they might have one of the best sitcom openings ever. Them on that roller coaster riding down that, right, that roller coaster that's sitting right by the ocean. It's beautiful. But think about that. Some people only get to star in one sitcom their entire acting career. And once it ends, it's over. But Susan Summers not only was fired from a hit television sitcom, she got to star in another one. So that's how resilient she is. And not only that, folks, not only is she a television sitcom actress and did she go on to star in another television sitcom after Three's Company, but she became an icon in the fitness world selling Thighmasters. I know you remember the Thighmaster commercials in the 90s.
Great legs.
Thank you.
How do you get them?
I used to do aerobics till I dropped. Then I found Thighmaster. Every single time you squeeze Thighmaster, you strengthen and tone right where you need it. So it's easy to squeeze your way to shapely hips and thighs.
I thought I'd never fit into these jeans again. Thank you, Thighmaster.
I recommend it.
I'm telling you, Thighmaster was everywhere in the 90s. And she didn't create the Thighmaster. She was the spokeswoman for it. And because of her being the spokeswoman for Thighmaster, they sold over 100 million Thighmasters in the 90s.
We may not have been born with great legs, but now we can look like we were.
And she was in her 40s looking like this. So a woman in her 40s selling fitness products to women in their 20s, that just proves to show you how big of an icon she was, a brilliant icon. And then after her television acting, she went on to host her own talk show called Suzanne. And I love that because it was on her talk show where she was able to create an opportunity to reunite with Joyce DeWitt, her Three's Company co-star. They hadn't seen each other since the show went off the air. Since she was fired from Three's Company, she hadn't seen Joyce DeWitt. And she created an opportunity on that sitcom or on her talk show to invite Joyce DeWitt on for a reunion. And, of course, when they were on her talk show talking about their reunion, they brought up John Ritter. Take a listen.
Yeah, it was enormous.
John. Mm-hmm. John. Mm-hmm. It still doesn't seem right to me. It's still... Yeah. You know, he called me after all those years, sort of like this, about a month before he died. I'm having my hair done, and they're washing my hair, and the receptionist comes over. She says, "You have a phone call." I said, "Thank you very much. Can you take a message, and I'll call whoever it is back?" She said, "It's John Ritter."
Honey.
Really? So I get on the phone. And there's John. And
I mean, can you believe that? It's the first time she's heard from John Ritter since she left Three's Company.
And he wanted you and me to do a dream sequence on his show,
yes.
Eight Simple, whatever
Eight Simple
those
rule,
rules.
For dating my daughter. Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't ready. I said, I just, you mean we're not even going to be in the scene with you? You're just going to shoot it? What, like after hours and then slot it in? It just,
yeah.
We needed to do this. Yeah. It's weird we have to do this in front of, I don't know how many people are watching.
When they first sent me that script, I called and I said, "Jonathan, you know, this is not a good script. You know, can they go back to the table?" And ultimately, when they went back to the table, as you know, they had his children on the show play us.
So the talk show revealed that John Ritter called Suzanne Summers and asked her to come on his new show, Eight Simple Rules. And he wanted to have a dream sequence where he was dreaming and he was back living in that apartment with Joyce DeWitt and Suzanne Summers. And it would have been a brilliant skit. But it ultimately didn't happen because John Ritter, as everybody knows, passed away from collapsing on the set of Eight Simple Rules and died of a massive heart attack. But Suzanne Summers, what is she known for? You can pick a lot of things. You can pick Three's Company. She is known by millions of people from that show. Or you could choose Thighmaster. Maybe you only know her from the fitness world. Or maybe you know her from the talk show world. Or maybe you know her from Step by Step. Regardless of where you know her from, she was certainly an icon. And it was so sad to hear that she passed away. But folks, we do have a great show ahead of you today. We have lots more Off the Cuff coming at you live. After these words, stick with us. We will be right back. Everybody to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Donnie on the show thread says, "Sad Three's Company was a part of many people's days, and Suzanne Summers was the biggest part of that program. She did that. She did what women in the industry are still fighting for today, and she needs to be recognized for what she tried to fight for years before anyone else tried." That's true. I mean, Suzanne Summers fought for equal pay for women. And she was turned down and fired and blackballed for a long time. She needs to be praised for what she did. She's a trailblazer. But look, folks, she is the epitome of resilience. Like I said, she bounced back to not only star in another talk show or another sitcom, but she became an icon in the fitness world. Amazing. But folks, it is October the 19th, slap dab still in the middle of spooky season. Halloween is just a couple of weeks away, October 31st to be exact. Lexington always does their trick-or-treating on the day of Halloween, so it will be on Tuesday. I will get those times to you next week of when the official trick-or-treat times will be. But folks, last week on the show, we started our Halloween celebration talking about the best horror movie theme songs of all time. Well, today on the show, I would like to continue our Halloween celebration and talk about television during Halloween. We've talked about on this show before the best television shows, the scariest television shows to ever exist. We talked about the scariest movies to ever exist. We've talked about horror movie openings, horror movie closings, the most iconic horror scenes. We've talked about a bunch of those things. But let's talk about TV, and specifically TV episodes to watch on Halloween. I would like to give some suggestions to the audience of some of the best TV episodes to watch for Halloween. Now, I come up with this topic because I was at home watching some former sitcoms that I used to love grow up watching on Hulu. And one of those sitcoms that I love watching is The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. And I always loved it when they had Halloween specials. And a lot of those sitcoms, for that matter, that had Halloween specials, they were always great. And because of streaming now, you don't really have to wait for shows to come on. And you can pull up shows that have existed from years past and watch them. So most people have streaming services, whether it's Hulu, Netflix, HBO Max, but I'm going to give you, the audience, some suggestions of the best TV episodes to watch for Halloween. Now, the following list that I have created are Halloween-themed episodes. Now, some of these are specifically more about the holiday Halloween, but some of these episodes don't mention Halloween, but instead they're just very, very spooky. So regardless, these on this list are the best TV episodes to watch on Halloween. And we're going to start with The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. The episode that I recommend you stream to watch to get in the mood for Halloween is an episode on Fresh Prince called Hex and the Single Guy. It's episode 7 of season 4, and it aired on October the 25th, 1993. In this Halloween special, the Bankses have been cursed. Hillary takes the family to a seance, believing she can contact her dead fiancé, Trevor. Will's constant mocking of the psychic causes him to curse the family with bad luck, and things quickly go from bad to worse. Carlton bleaches his hair, Phil is fired from his job, and Jeffrey, the butler, announces his engagement, or I'm sorry, Jeff Towns, the jazz in the show, announces his engagement to Hillary, and Jeffrey the butler gets deported back to his country. And this is all because of the hex that Will Smith got put on the family. Let's take a listen to some of the best clips or best scenes from that episode, Hex and the Single Guy from The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Take a listen.
I think you should just give my uncle his money back. You know, we all had a good laugh, but this whole thing is bogus, and you, sir, are a fake.
Nobody calls me the F word. Mole sumo kamadad. Is kadak. Is kadem. Shalarim. Shalarim.
Gitchy, gitchy, ya, 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 ya.
From this day forward, you will bring evil to all those in your presence. You will end up alone and forever hexed. I placed a curse on you.
This isn't funny, Will. You ruined my seance.
Forget the seance. He may have ruined our lives once this hex kicks in. Cut it out, Carlton. There is no such thing as a... Oh, my God. Carlton, what is that hideous thing growing out of your neck?
What? What? Where? Where?
Never mind. It's just your head.
Is it?
The DA says he has proof that I took bribes.
What?
How? I've been suspended from the bench. My reputation is destroyed. I'm ruined.
I want you to know that regardless of what happens, I'll always be at your side. Carlton, what the hell happened to your hair? Oh, no, you don't. I'm not falling for that again. Oh, my hair. I look like a snow cone. What happened?
Oh, the hex. Oh, Carlton, that's not it. That gold
stuff you sprayed on your head must have done something to your hair, and I just watch it out.
Oh, I did! Last night! Woodley was attacked by the tennis ball machine!
Found those Polaroids!
It's all missed one bit!
Are you Jeffrey Butler?
Yes, I am. And you must be the woman of my dreams. You are!
Jeffrey Butler. I'm Agent Wanda Davis, Immigration and Naturalization. You're in this country illegally.
Uncle Phil!
No buts, Butler. You're being deported. Let's go.
Oh, God.
And that, folks, is just a few little clips of that episode. It's a hilarious episode, but it's kind of scary because all of these bad things are happening to the Banks family, and you're wondering, oh my gosh, will everything ever end up okay again? Okay, next on the list, folks, as some of the best TV episodes to watch for Halloween, this next episode I'm going to recommend to you comes from the sitcom Boy Meets World that aired on ABC back in the 90s. And this episode comes from season 5, episode 17. And this episode is called And Then There Was Sean. And this episode was very freaky because in this episode, there is a serial killer in the high school that the kids go to school in, and a bunch of people wind up dead. And there's spooky music that ends up playing across the intercom at school. The lights go out. Nobody's to be found. And all kinds of scary, spooky things happens, and nobody knows why. Take a listen at a clip.
Scared? No, 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 you scream when the lights go off. The scream when the lights come on takes away from the first scream. Now you're just being loud.
Welcome to John Adams High, where you are gonna...
This is on the intercom.
Feeny, you are so low budget.
Wake up, Sean. This could not be Mr. Feeny.
No, then what? There really is some psycho killer on the loose? You'd rather believe that?
Oh, my God! What? My basketball's gone, too!
No, it's not. I've got it.
Oh, good.
I don't care who's behind this. I'm scared. Can we please get out of here?
Of course we can't get out of here. Feeny is the only one with the keys to all the doors, and they're all locked and chained by now.
Now they're running around the hall trying to find a way out of the school, and they finally come across Mr. Feeny, who is just standing there, not saying anything, until he falls on his knees because he has been stabbed. And Mr. Feeny is dead. Now you come to find out at the end of the episode why all this was happening, and I'm not going to spoil it for you. Even though the show is over 25 years old, I still don't want to spoil this Halloween special for you. All right, the next one on the list that I'm going to talk about as one of the best TV episodes to watch for Halloween comes from the sitcom Family Matters. Now, Family Matters went all out for this one. This particular episode is about an evil doll that Steve Urkel created, because Steve Urkel got into ventriloquist dummies, and he created his own doll that looked like him. Well, Steve took a nap, and the doll got struck by lightning and came alive. So it's very much like the Chucky movies. But the ventriloquist doll that looked like Steve Urkel was an evil doll that tried to take the souls of the Winslow family. Take a listen at a clip from this episode.
Sure is, bone butt. Thanks for flushing me down the toilet, pal. I spent the last year hanging out in sewers, bobbing for rats.
What do you want?
Oh, not much. Just your soul.
Why don't you take the guys next door? He's a lawyer. He's never used these.
I won't settle for just any soul. I want yours.
I mean, how freaky is that? This is from a TGIF sitcom made for family, and they really went all out having an evil dummy try to take the soul of the family that stars in the sitcom. Now, this was such a good episode that they did another Halloween special the very next year on Halloween, and they called it Stevel 2. And in that episode, Carl, which plays the dad in the sitcom, gets his own doll made for him, which also becomes evil, and the two team up to try to kill the family. And there are so many good episodes that I didn't mention, so many episodes that I wish I could have put on the list, but I don't have time for. There are so many Roseanne episodes, there's so many Modern Family episodes, there's so many Office episodes, Friends episodes, so many great Halloween specials that all these sitcoms put together that I would love to put on the list, but simply because of time, I can't. But folks, those are just a few best episodes to watch this year for Halloween, if you're looking for something to watch. All right, folks, we're going to take a quick break. Stick with us. We will be right back.
Very superstitious.
Everybody to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Last week we talked about Friday the 13th, which I hope everybody had a good Friday the 13th and everybody had good luck. I know for some, 13 is a lucky number for many. I had a very good Friday the 13th, went down to a festival. You got to love the festivals that are always happening in the fall. Went down to Bath County to the Preston Festival, and that was an experience to say the least. But it was on Friday the 13th and nothing bad happened. It was actually a really good day, which just goes to show you that Friday the 13th, that whole fear, that whole aura of it being an evil day, it being bad luck, is a superstition. And there are a lot of superstitions out there around the world. There's very common superstitions that exist. And last week on the show thread, Wade asked me a question that I never did get to answer. He asked me, Adam, what are some of your superstitions that you have? Well, I think just like anybody, I've got my own superstitions. And I might not really believe hardcore these superstitions, but I'm not going to go out of my way to do something just because of the superstition. Like, breaking a mirror is 7 years bad luck. That's what they say. I don't necessarily believe that. However, I'm not going to go on purpose break mirrors just for the risk of it. Now, call that superstition or not, that's just the way I look at it. But it made me start thinking of the most common superstitions that exist around the world. And there's a bunch, like breaking a mirror is 7 years bad luck. What about knocking on wood? Knocking on wood is basically what you need to do if you want to bring yourself good luck or you don't want to jinx yourself. You knock on wood. The fixation on wood may come from old myths about good spirits and trees from an association with the Christian cross, according to most studies. So, these superstitions that exist out there in the world, do you ever wonder, where did it come from? Like, who started the superstition? I know I do. What about find a penny, pick it up, and all day long you'll have good luck? It says here that this little ditty may arise because finding money is lucky in it of itself, but it might also be a spinoff of another old rhyme, see a pin, pick it up, and all day long you'll have good luck. See a pin, let it lay, and your luck will pass away. Another superstition that is very common out there around the world is to not walk under a ladder. Basically, they say if you walk under a ladder, you're bringing yourself bad luck. It says here that one theory holds that this superstition arises from a Christian belief in the Holy Trinity, since a ladder leaning against a wall forms a triangle. Breaking that ladder triangle was blasphemous. So basically, if you walk under a ladder, you're asking for bad luck. What about black cats crossing your path, whether they run across the road or they just come in your direction and they just kind of go from one end of your peripheral to the other? If a black cat crosses the road, that's supposed to mean evil things are coming, evil things are lurking, bad luck is about to happen. That's one of those things where I don't necessarily believe it because I see black cats all the time. Black cats, I go to the Red Mile and I see a black cat every time I'm walking out of the Red Mile. Now, that probably doesn't help my belief on not believing that because I always have bad luck at the Red Mile. So the fact that I seen a black cat after I walk out of the Red Mile makes a lot of sense. I really do. I see a black cat run across the sidewalk every time I leave the Red Mile. Is that because I just got finished having a ton of bad luck? What about they say that bad luck comes in threes? That is a superstition. What about the number 666, which we all know is the number of the beast, but a lot of people cannot stand to have 666 written anywhere around them, whether it be at the grocery store or whether it be a telephone number, they do not like it. A lot of people, if their bill rings up 666 at the grocery store, they're like, nope, let me buy a stick of chewing gum to make the bill 667. Instead of 666, because people feel like that if they have that number, they have somewhat accepted the number of the beast, which is really not the case. It's got to be 666 before you can ever get to 667. Another common superstition out there around the world is make a wish on a wishbone. They usually do this on Thanksgiving, find the wishbone inside the turkey, make a wish, break the wishbone, and it will come true. Crossing your fingers is another common superstition out there. Basically, if you cross your fingers, it's more likely to happen. That's why people say fingers crossed, keep your fingers crossed. What about don't open an umbrella inside the house? That is another very common superstition that we have around the world. Apparently, opening an umbrella is just like walking under a ladder. It will bring you bad luck if you do that. There's also a superstition that beginners have beginner's luck. So if you are somebody just trying to play a game for the first time, you're going to have a lot of luck doing it because you are a beginner. Like if you've never played poker before and you go play poker for the first time, superstition says that you're going to have a lot of good luck playing that game of poker. What about the superstition of throwing salt over your shoulder? Basically, if you spill the salt at a table, you're supposed to rake the salt off the table onto your hand and throw it over your shoulder. And if you don't do that, that can bring you a ton of bad luck, almost like a curse. It reminds me of Dumb and Dumber when he spills the salt and Harry tells him to throw it. Well, Lloyd tells Harry to throw the salt over his shoulder, and instead of throwing the salt, he throws the whole daggone salt shaker over his shoulder, and it hits Seabass in the lap, and Seabass is ready to retaliate. Hilarious. Sweeping under someone's feet. They say if you sweep under someone's feet, you'll never get married. Speaking of me at the Red Mile, there's always a little man there at the Red Mile that's always sweeping up the floors when I'm playing the slots. And one day I was just joking around with him, and I said, buddy, you're going to make it to where I never get married, because he was sweeping under my feet. And I don't think he understood my joke. I don't think he really heard of that superstition. So it makes me wonder, is that a common superstition? Has anybody on the show thread ever heard of that? That sweeping under your feet means you're not going to get married? Because I grew up thinking that. So maybe people need to sweep under my feet a little bit longer because I'm good over here being unmarried. Itchy palms, they say, is another superstition. It says here that it originated from the Caribbean, and depending on which palm of yours begins to itch, you may find yourself in the Caribbean with a bit of extra spending money or in the red. It is a common belief that an itchy left palm means you will owe money soon, whereas an itchy right palm means money is coming your way. There is an explanation that might tell us why such a distinction. The left hand seems to hold passive energy and the right hand active energy, which symbolically could explain the coming in and out of money. So all kinds of superstitions. There's a superstition that if your ears are burning, someone is talking about you. There's a superstition that if your nose itches, that you're going to get company. If your foot falls asleep, there's a superstition that says that you're going to be walking in new territory very, very soon. So there is a ton of superstitions out there, and that, folks, I feel like are the most common ones. Kathy on the show thread says that she has indeed heard of the sweeping under the feet superstition. So I knew I wasn't the only one that heard that. But if you have a superstition out there that I haven't said, throw it up on the show thread and I'll certainly say it. But folks, this seems like a good time to take Off the Cuff's Song of the Week break. And how about a little punk rock with a little original prankster with The Offspring? Enjoy the song. We'll be back after it's over. I think this is a great time to give the audience Off the Cuff's quote of the week, and this week's quote comes from a lady named Mandy Hale. Mandy Hale is a blogger turned New York Times bestselling author and speaker, creator of the social media movement The Single Woman. Mandy cuts to the heart of single life with her inspirational, straight-talking, witty takes on love and life. And the quote of the week is this: change is painful, but nothing is as painful as staying stuck somewhere you don't belong. Change is painful, but nothing is as painful as staying stuck somewhere you don't belong. We've talked about change on this show before. Change is very difficult. It's uncomfortable. It makes you feel weird. It makes you feel awkward. It puts you out of your comfort zone. Putting yourself in unfamiliar territory is never a comfortable thing to do. But change, and because of that, change can be very painful, because a lot of the times life as we knew it is not the same anymore once we change. Really, doing anything, when we change anything in our life, it's painful. But you know what's more painful than that? Is staying stuck somewhere you don't belong. And the reason you're staying stuck in that certain place is because you are afraid of change and the pain change will bring. Well, the pain that being stuck somewhere you don't belong will overpower the pain that change will bring you. Because with change means new opportunity. And if you change your life, if you change things about your situation, new things can come about. New great things can come about. I have had a lot of change happen in my life over the last 7 or 8 months. And at the time, I thought that it was bad change. I thought that it wasn't going to get better. And I thought that the change was negative. But I have come to an understanding that that change needed to happen. I was actually stuck in doing a certain routine every single day. And I was stuck doing something that I shouldn't have been doing, even with this show, every single week. But when the change happened, I realized that it was change that needed to happen. And because of that change, I wasn't stuck anymore and things started to flourish. So change is painful, folks, but nothing is as painful as staying stuck somewhere you don't belong. So don't stay stuck in a situation just because you're afraid of changing, whether it's a job, whether it's a relationship, whether it's staying friends with someone. Yes, when you change something in your life that's significant, like a job or a spouse or a girlfriend, boyfriend, friend, when you kick them out of your life or you change jobs, yes, change is going to happen. And yes, that can be uncomfortable and a little painful. But ultimately, staying stuck somewhere that you know you don't belong is going to be more painful in the end. So cut your losses and move on quickly. All right, folks, we're going to take one more break because we have one more segment to go. Stick with us. We will be right back. Wait. Everybody to Off the Cuff, last segment of the hour. Adam Banks here with you. After a fast start last Saturday night at Kroger Field, things quickly turned ugly for Mark Stoops and the number 23 Kentucky Wildcats as they would fall to number 25 Missouri, 38-21, which means the Wildcats fell to 5-2 overall on the season and 2-2 in the conference. They are now on a bye week, and they'll be not playing football this weekend, but their next game will be on October the 28th against Tennessee, a huge opponent. Kentucky is being outscored 40-14 in the middle eight through four SEC games. Vandy went 13-0 and Missouri went 10-0. The latter obviously mattered more. Every opponent has scored on a second quarter two-minute touchdown drive. That's bad situational football. That's bad coaching is what you call that. That has to improve drastically. You know, losing to Missouri is unacceptable. It is. I mean, being Kentucky, being a football school is what a lot of fans like to say we are now. If we're going to call ourselves a football school, can we really call ourselves a football school when we're losing at Kroger Field, at home, in Lexington, to Missouri? No, you can't. Mark Stoops, I have been very vocal on him through many, 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 many different episodes here on the show. I've even went on different podcasts. I went on the KSR Pennant Deep podcast and aired my grievances with Mark Stoops and the job that he's done at Kentucky. Listen, he goes into this bye week 5-2 and 2-2 in the season. It made me start thinking, folks, are we stuck with Mark Stoops as our lifetime coach at Kentucky? And I think we are. I think that we are stuck with him as our lifetime coach. And that makes a lot of people happy, which blows my mind that it makes people happy that we're stuck with Mark Stoops as our lifetime coach. We have him, according to his contract, we have Mark Stoops until June 2031. And currently he makes $9 million a year to lose to teams like Missouri. Listen, he has only beaten two SEC schools with winning records. That was Florida, who was 5-3, and South Carolina, who was 5-3. The rest of the SEC schools that he defeated had losing records. That is an astonishing stat, and I talked about that stat last week. The numbers don't lie. If you really want to look at the numbers of what Mark Stoops has done here, he's done nothing. And keeping a coach like Mark Stoops, we're missing out on all these coaches that come available when they lose their previous job and they become available. We miss out on these coaches because we love Mark Stoops at Kentucky. For instance, we missed out on Lincoln Riley, the coach for the USC Trojans. I mean, if you're a quarterback, you're going to want to play for Lincoln Riley. Look at the notable quarterbacks that played for him: Baker Mayfield, Kyler Murray, Jalen Hurts, Caleb Williams, just to name a few. I mean, think about that. Look at what he's been able to do at USC since he's became the coach. What about Brian Kelly with LSU? Kelly took over an LSU program that went below 500 in 2021, and in his first year there, LSU won 10 games and the SEC West title. How many times has Mark Stoops won the SEC East title? None. How many years has he been there? 11. How many has Brian Kelly been at LSU? Well, he won it in his first year, the SEC West title. Before that, Brian Kelly posted 5 top 10 finishes since 2009 while at Cincinnati and Notre Dame. He brought the Fighting Irish to 3 college football playoffs and a BCS national championship game. Brian Kelly was a proven winner and should have had LSU competing for another SEC West championship this season. So that's insane. We missed out on somebody like him. We missed out on somebody like Luke Fickle that coaches Wisconsin. Luke Fickle has won at least 9 games in his last 5 years at Cincinnati as Cincinnati's head coach. In 2021, he took the Bearcats to the football college playoffs. Now, Luke Fickle heads to Wisconsin, where he should have the Wisconsin Badgers competing for the Big Ten championships sooner rather than later. Mark Stoops has no playoff appearances. He's never beaten a number one ranked team. He's never been number one in anything. So why is it that we are so infatuated with Mark Stoops? He's only beat two SEC teams with a winning record. He only has two winning SEC seasons in the 10 seasons he's been there, soon to be 11 seasons. What's the infatuation? I don't get it. I don't understand it. I don't. As long as we keep him as our coach, we're going to forever miss out on these other coaches that could come and do a better job. Mark Stoops is not the only name in town. So instead of screaming at the coach or at the refs, Mark Stoops, every time that you want to look like you know what you're doing or you want to look like and make people think that you're coaching, why don't you take some time to look at the numbers and realize that you haven't done anything? And the reason he hates me so much is because he's a fraud, and I call him out every single week on this show. And he knows he's a fraud. And he really gets nervous when he hears people exposing him. And he hears me exposing him all the time. Because, Stoops, you are a fraud. The numbers don't lie. Will he beat Tennessee next Saturday? No! Why? Because he don't know how to beat big teams. He don't. He's beaten two SEC teams with winning records in 11 years. And makes $9 million a year. Time to get rid of him. Time to get rid of Stoops to hire somebody else. I named several coaches that we missed out on that is now having success at their programs. I mean, look, all these coaches here that I named have at least been, have done one of the following, made it to the playoffs, been number one, or at least beat a number one ranked team. Stoops has, think about this, this will blow your mind. Stoops has never beaten a number one ranked team. Never. Rich Brooks at least did that. Mark Stoops hasn't even beaten Georgia before. He won't be at Alabama this year. And it will continue to be like this as long as he's here. But the Cats do play Tennessee coming up in their next game, and that will be on October the 26th at 7:30. And it will be a fun game to watch. All right, folks, if you liked what you heard today, you'll probably like our previous episodes. We put all of our episodes on podcasts. We're on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube. So if you missed our episodes, you can subscribe on podcasts to listen to all of them. You can follow me on social media at The Adam Banks. I am on Instagram. I am on Facebook, and I am on Twitter. You can follow the show on social media at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. We are on Instagram, Facebook, and TikTok. We release new episodes every Thursday right here on WLXU 93.9 FM, which means we will be back same time, same place. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Adam Banks, and this is Off the Cuff. I'll catch you down the road. 'Cause I've been going dancing in the-